See, this is power. This voice, this is power. In anybody else's hands, this is a microphone. In my hands, it's a pipe bomb.
From pillar to post and coast to coast, this is the law.
Live audio record.
We are live!
Your number one source for pro wrestling and mixed martial arts news, interviews, and opinions.
We live, we breathe, we sweat, we paid the price to be the best.
With Dan the Mouth Lovranski.
The cream of the crop.
Jason Agnew.
Don't make him angered, please.
And John Pollock.
Where's the producer?
Live audio wrestling on TSN Radio.
Now it's time for streaming scout. It's the law.
I can't believe it.
Laws of motion say to every action there's an equal and opposite reaction. Last week we talked about the best of 2012. Thus tonight we shall chat about the worst. All those moments, angles, and feuds that make you embarrassed to be a wrestling fan. Hello everyone and welcome to the Lots Live Audio Wrestling coming at you on TSN 1050 Toronto, the Team 1410 Vancouver, and online at liveaudiowrestling.com. My name is Jason Agnew and tonight the whole Law crew is back in studio. Dan Lovranski, John Pollock, Wai Ting, Mouth, it's the worst of the year.
Well, you know, Jay, this is one of the shows that I really wait for at the end of every year so we can finally flush all the crap away and get ready to start all over again. Next week. Now, if you're looking for positive thoughts, that was last week's show. This week, it's the bad, ugly, gross, sickening, disgusting, infuriating worst of 2012. That's right. It's our salute to TNA. Actually, we go after everybody in this one, folks. No one is unscathed in the Law's worst of 2012, and we'll make all our picks known right here tonight. We'll also be joined by Dave Meltzer of the Wrestling Observer Extra, and you'll get your chance to win your own very special Worst of the Year prize pack during Title Bout Trivia. And tonight, of course, as always, we want to hear from you, but we really want to hear from you tonight. We're going to give our picks for the worst of 2012, and then we're going to open up the lines of communication and let you have your say. What made you sick in 2012? Inquiring minds want to know.
We are going to do that in the second hour of tonight's program. Till that time, if you want to express your thoughts, you can tweet us at Law Radio or join the conversation at lawradio.proboards.com. Going to take a quick break and then we're going to be back running it all down for you. The worst of the worst 2012 is what we're doing tonight on The Law Live Audio Wrestling.
You're listening to Live Audio Wrestling
with Hulk Hogan, the new world order of wrestling, brother. We will destroy the whole wrestling business
on TSN Radio.
It's 11 o'clock. Do you know where your children are? Because if they were watching the TNA pay-per-view, I guarantee you they're now asleep. It's our recap and rundown of TNA Not-So-Victory Road. Safe to say that TNA's good run of pay-per-views has officially come to a crashing and burning halt as they present a turd of a show. If we didn't have to do this radio show, you would have had to have locked me down in order to make me watch what I just had to watch. And Bound for Glory has us bound for mediocrity. And we ask you again this year, Loyal Law fans, was anything resolved at TNA's Final Resolution pay-per-view? We watch these things so you don't have to. I did not know that was coming, John Pollock. Very funny.
I would love to say that took me a long time, but it really didn't because I just grabbed all the TNA recaps from this year. And outside of three pay-per-views,
that's right,
they all followed a similar trend.
And it was actually three pay-per-views in a row from what I remember.
Yes, yes.
They had this good span of pay-per-views this year, but other than that,
May, June, July.
My favorite was
in the middle of the year
when I called one a turd.
Turd of a pay-per-view.
I love that word. Welcome back to it. John Pollock is the other voice you hear. Dan Lovranski. And, of course, I just saw posted on Facebook, Wai, tonight you are interested in celebrating the hate.
Yes, I am. Yes. I don't think we're negative enough throughout the entire year. So.
This show really doesn't get that criticism enough.
No,
yeah, really.
So tonight we're doing our worst of 2012 wrestling and MMA special here on Live Audio Wrestling.
As we set off the top, and as that montage proves, our special salute to TNA right here, ladies and gentlemen.
There is quite a bit of TNA on my list tonight, and I'm sure everyone else
Are we all doing Claire Lynch shots tonight every time that name is uttered?
That would be a good drinking game for those of you listening at home. Every time you hear Claire Lynch, take a shot.
Well, let's get into it. She doesn't qualify for a first category of the night, and that is the worst wrestler of the year. Dan Lovranski, kick us off.
Matt Bloom, ladies and gentlemen. Matt Bloom.
Yeah.
Matt Bloom. Tensai. Terrible. Terrible. Terrible.
Absolutely. That surprises me.
Why?
I'm surprised that that's where you went with it. I did not expect that to come out.
I just think because
horrible year.
He did, he had a terrible year. I mean, he came from Japan where he got all this pub and everybody seemed to be think he was revitalized as a wrestler and he was going to be this great new character. They brought him back. They gave him a gimmick that really in this day and age I don't think you can get away
with. Beat Cena and Punk on television.
Exactly, out of the gate. Exactly. Yeah. Huge wins out of the gate. And then I think people realized no one bought the gimmick. No one got it. Everybody just went, it's Albert again. And then the company realized what was going on. They turned him into a giant jobber. And even those spots where he had the matches with Ryback, and poor Ryback was trying to get him up there for the for the move. I don't know if Tenzai was sandbagging him or what, but just terrible performance. Going from, like, coming in hot, getting a big push, and then just
jobbing out to Santino at the house show.
Exactly. Jobbing out to, like, everybody on the roster. I'm waiting for Hornswoggle to beat him. So there you go, Tenzai. Why is that such a surprise?
I don't know. I just didn't expect
it. He was terrible this year.
He was indeed. I agree with you. Okay, John, where are you headed with this?
This is a previous winner of this award, and he's had a roller coaster in law history, but I'm going with The Miz. I thought he was just absolutely terrible this year, whether it was as a heel or a babyface. He had the losing streak gimmick. I think his babyface run has been one of the worst I have ever seen, and I really don't have much of an answer as to what you even do with this guy at this point. Just turn away heat for me at this point with Mike Mizanin.
I agree. That is pretty bad. Okay, Wai.
I went with more of just looking at it from a technical standpoint, and I think of all the regular wrestlers in both TNA and the WWE right now, I don't think there is a worse wrestler than the Great Khali at the moment. Just extremely limited in mobility and just a guy that half the time doesn't really seem to know what he's doing when he's out there. I don't know if you guys saw that Christmas special, but he's trying to...
He was terrible,
Yes.
Or We Wish You a Merry Christmas. I'm sure that was a rib put out there by somebody. Hey, Khali, go out there and you know, we'll see what happens.
Yeah.
And benefited by CM Punk in the next segment.
Not a good match all year. Basically, at this point, just a comedy sideshow.
I agree with you, Wai. That is my choice as well. The Great Khali. It's really just sad to see him in there now. He should just be not being put in the ring before. Yeah. You know, he's not a monster. He serves no purpose. I don't find any comedy in him either. I just think that he should be removed from the organization. From there, we'll go to there's a lot of people to choose from here.
Yeah. Very heated race this year.
Worst wrestler, worst female wrestler is what we're choosing now. We had a hard time choosing a best female, a worst. Yes. Female, a lot of competition.
That's easy. Well, I mean, I couldn't pick my favorite, which is Kelly Kelly, because she wasn't around for half the year.
I suppose
even for that little bit, I could say. But I agree. There's so many that you can pick from in both TNA and the WWE. I went with Oksana. She just, to me, looks like she's... Especially now that they've put her in the ring.
Yeah.
I didn't mind her so much as a sidekick or as the hot chick on the guy's arm, but... In the ring, especially there was that Divas tag this week. She looked just terrible. She doesn't seem to look like... She knows she doesn't belong. She looks like the deer in the headlights. She doesn't know what she's doing. Yeah, best she not be in there.
Oksana, it is for Dan Lovranski. John Pollock?
I don't doubt that my pick could maybe eventually get somewhere, but this year when she was put on television, she was just so incredibly green, and that was Taylor Hendricks, who came in through the gut check challenge and then returned to do a match with Tara a couple of weeks back. I just not ready even for a taped show at this point in TNA's women's division, and I just think just didn't belong on television at this point in her career.
Wai Ting, over to you.
I am going with Oksana as well. Just, I mean, Taylor Hendricks, I totally understand what you're saying, John, but, I mean, she is put there as sort of, not a full-time member of the roster yet. Whereas Oksana, she has graduated NXT. She's been through a number of managerial roles. At this point, you'd expect her to at least know how to, I don't know, do an elbow drop, which she clearly doesn't.
No.
I went with, because this girl, for some reason, TNA sees something in here and pushes her right to the top, I'm picking Velvet Sky. I don't understand the fascination. I don't think she's attractive. I don't know why pigeons are living in her vagina.
I never did get that either.
What the hell are pigeons?
Yeah, I never did get that either.
Well,
which will come up in a couple categories.
All right, well, fine.
I'm with you. I could never figure out what that's all about.
And I don't know the fascination with Velvet Sky. I just don't see it. I think that someone like Madison Rayne has a much greater upside than Velvet Sky does. I see nothing, no mic skills. I see no ring skills. I see nothing from this woman. And I don't understand why they brought her back.
I was just going to say, you must be happy she's back then.
Yeah, exactly, right? And she's back, looking like gold dust. Worst tag team is where we are headed to now. Dan Lovranski?
Well, I mean, it was actually a good year for tag teams in some instances, right? We got a bit of a revitalization in both TNA and the WWE. I went with a TNA tag team they were broken up by March, but that doesn't matter because they stunk, and I went with Morgan and Crimson.
Oh, yeah.
I just couldn't handle it. They were done by Victory Road in March, but they were so bad together, and the feud was terrible, and Morgan, I hate him in any role, and Crimson, I'm just glad he's disappeared, but I thought they were terrible, so that's my pick. Morgan and Crimson.
John Pollock. I went to Ring of Honor, and I went with the Guardians of Truth, who were the former and now the present Headbangers, who were brought into Ring of Honor without really any rhyme or reason, put in these black outfits and put under masks. It made no sense. It was such a cheesy, gimmick, right out of the 70s. Now they've unmasked them and are promoting them as the Headbangers, but I thought they served no purpose here to be brought in with Truth Martini, and it was just such a lame, lame gimmick and not any bit of rewarding.
That's the thing. You got nothing out of that.
Wasn't even an unmasking to it at all. Nope. They're the Headbangers now, which legally I don't even know how they're able to get around, but that's another question.
Wai Ting, worst tag team.
I also went with Matt Morgan and Crimson, and it was, like you guys said, a good year for tag team wrestling, and actually kind of hard to pick one of these. Because, I mean, to be a bad tag team, I think there's not really too many standout terrible tag teams, more just tag teams that you don't even think about, that they're just completely ineffective. Whereas I think Morgan and Crimson, they did stand out.
I will say, as we talk about this renaissance, I think the bar for tag wrestling has also been brought down significantly. This year is considered this golden year because they focused on them. It's not like anyone was really lighting the world on fire outside of maybe Daniels and Kazarian to some. But, I mean, the primetime players are now considered a good tag team just by the standards.
I'm going to go a little outside the box here, and I'm going to select Eric Young and ODB. They held tag titles together, the women's tag titles together, which is a terrible idea for a man to hold a women's title, unless you're Andy Kaufman. They never really wrestled together. Any interaction they had was horrific. Eric Young wasn't there half the time because he was filming stuff. I hate these two together. I have nothing for these two. Just absolutely, completely, and utterly useless. And I like Eric Young as a solo character. I just think that these two together were poisonous.
They're life partners.
They're both just awful.
Yeah.
Worst on the microphone, Dan Lovransky.
Get ready to drink. I picked Claire Lynch. I mean, she was only there for a month or two, but every time she got anywhere near a microphone, it was horrendous. She just screamed her lines all the time. She showed no kind of ability, despite the fact that we heard that she wants to be an actress. She showed no ability whether to play a role at all. She screamed every one of her lines. I wanted to throw a brick at the TV every time she came on screen. So I have a bunch of broken TVs in my living room.
There you have it. John.
I went with The Miz. I just, for a guy that is pushed as someone that is in that upper echelon in the WWE, to me, he is the prototype of what is so wrong. Yes.
Oh, my. Exactly.
Oh, I hate that. Just to me, it's like this generation, there are mic workers that you just, the person and the character, they just don't jive with the words coming out of their mouth. And to me, he's the epitome of this, where it's just, this is a guy that has recited lines. I don't understand anything about this character. It's such a turnoff for me. I'm never invested in anything he's involved with. And this babyface stuff has just been horrific for me.
Definitely. Way.
It's hard to disagree with Mouth's choice with Claire Lynch here, but I have to agree with John and say The Miz, simply because we've seen him be given opportunities in both a babyface and a heel capacity mm-hmm. and fail miserably at both. And it's, you know, there are guys that are sometimes just bad on the mic, but then there are guys that are embarrassing on the mic, and The Miz's performances as a babyface as of late have been pretty embarrassing.
I completely agree with you there, and it's funny because The Miz is someone that I believe, you know, a couple years ago, we would have mentioned on the Best Of show.
I believe 2 years ago I had him as my best wrestler.
2010, he was fresh, he had the title.
I really liked him back then. I thought he was showing great potential, he was going to do something, but the last 2 years have not been good.
And a lot of that has to do with no evolution of the character.
Right.
When the character remains stagnant and does not evolve, and someone that I'm picking in this category has just stopped evolving 8 years ago, I think, maybe 5 years ago, Mr. Anderson. I hate this person. I just dislike this person as a whole. When
must
he touches a microphone,
must have loved Impact this
it's
week.
It's terrible. And there is just no evolution. He had he had something, perhaps with that asshole thing that he was trying for, and
no,
I was high on it at a certain point when it first happened, and he beats everything to death. He's not funny whatsoever, and I think he's very much the Miz of TNA. Is really, and you don't know if he's a babyface or a
heel.
Those
are the two.
I don't know what he is.
I was weighing, and I went with the Miz because he was around more.
I'd say Anderson was better 8 years ago.
You know, by far.
Under the control of the WWE.
Yeah.
Yes. Let's continue on here to another person who doesn't know how to use a microphone, and that'll be our worst announcer of the year. I can see a sleeve.
I don't think Mouth is going to surprise anyone.
No, okay, go for it, Mouth.
You know, when we do sit down to do these every year.
First thing?
Well, yeah, the first thing that I do every year is...
Category just right in right away.
With both best and worst is I instantly go in and do the ones that instantly pop into my head.
I do the same thing, Mouth.
Yeah, it's okay, bang, bang, because there's always a few where you can go bang, 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 bang.
This is one.
This is exactly the worst list. This is the first one I do every year. I'm sure he's the longest running winner in this category for me, and that's Taz from TNA. It's just abysmal. I don't care who you put with him. I don't care what you do with him. He does no research. He puts no effort into his commentary. I don't even know if that's him behind the glasses half the time. I really resent the fact that he goes out there and doesn't do any prep at all. No. And that him and Tanay get in these dumb arguments with each other, and there'll be a great match going on and they're not paying attention. I hate it, and I don't see him ever getting any better, and I don't see him ever getting out of this category.
John.
Yeah, I also go with Taz, and I'm someone that I have been a fan of Taz in the past, and I've defended him at times to Mouth, and this past year, I just thought it was just, this guy has just become beyond comically bad at this point, and I think Tanay actually is getting pretty bad himself now in this kind of just weird third man role with Todd Kennelly. Tanay just kind of, the two of them just getting these stupid jokes, like let's out joke one another, and it really has pulled down a lot of shows for me, these two, and just how little seriousness Taz puts into this, and it affects your product a lot. It's not simply just a bad promo. This is a constant voice for the whole three-hour pay-per-view.
The crazy thing about it, too, is, I mean, you mentioned how it's bringing down Tanay as well, and you'd think Tanay would have learned from those years on Nitro when the same sort of thing started to happen in the final days of Nitro when they all didn't care about the product and they would just go out there and try to amuse themselves. You'd think Tanay would maybe try to get past that, but you're right. Him and Taz have this really weird thing where they just crack bad jokes, and it's real annoying.
Are we sweeping Way?
Yeah, because I got to go with Taz as well.
Yeah.
And what one of the things that you guys, I guess, didn't mention, but really gets on my nerves about
Taz. Oh, there's lots of things about Taz to cover, Way.
He not only doesn't do his research, but he gets on Todd Kennelly's case for doing research. And just the number of times, I guess it's sort of a gimmick of his now,
right.
or Kennelly would mention a signature move, and Taz would make fun of him for doing the research. You wrestling nerd, you know, eat defeat, come on.
Yeah, I am picking Taz as well, and I think that, you know, he was bad and has only gotten worse in comparison to Todd Kennelly, who's a fresh voice on the show and is definitely excited to be there, and you can feel that in his commentary.
It'll get beaten out of him.
Of course it will. It's TNA. Worst non-wrestling performer, I'm going to guess on another sweep here, gentlemen.
Woo! Drink! Claire Lynch, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, I don't see how you can pick anyone. I know she was only there for a couple of months, but for all the reasons I said before, can't act her way out of a paper bag, screams all her lines, and plus involved in a really, really bad, annoying angle.
Yeah.
back to Universal Studios for her acting career to progress. Yeah. I also went with Claire Lynch, but I also want to take this time to give an honorable mention to Vince McMahon, because I thought every time he showed up this year, he is horrendously bad. Just a caricature of himself, but nowhere in the league of Claire Lynch, who's my pick.
Very true. Way.
Our own favorite, Julia Riley, Claire Lynch. I think not only because of the terrible performances, but at her response to the criticism that was given to her online.
I mean, she's not a fan of our message board.
Not at all. No, but I mean, no matter what business you're in, you're going to be receiving criticism.
And you're going to be known. If you're on a show, people are going to know who you are.
Yeah. And to just simply storm out of your role that people have committed a lot of money towards to you simply because of that, I think is incredibly unprofessional.
Yeah, from the girl that's playing olive oil at the Popeye ride. Like, come on. This is friggin' ridiculous.
He's not making this up.
That's just all true.
Just ridiculous. And I agree with Wai. That's one of the worst things about her. It's like, come on, you didn't think people are going to find out about your background?
This stormed out and created headaches for people that were trying to make a storyline out of this. I mean, she was incredibly unprofessional and just a horrible, horrible footnote in wrestling history.
Claire Lynch is my winner here. I'd like to take time, though, much like John did, to give an honorable mention to Brooke Hogan.
Yeah, absolutely. I had her down as well. Yeah, absolutely. And not getting better. She was terrible this week.
She definitely was. All right, we're going to take a break here. When we come back, we're going to continue on.
This we're just is getting warmed up.
Yeah, we are. This is the worst of the worst this week, guys. It's one of our favorite shows to do. Tweet out any if you guys feel as though you got other answers choices. To our categories.
Choices. Nominees.
At Law Radio. Winners. You can tweet them out to. And we're going to come back and we're going to worst gimmick, worst match of the year, worst feud of the year. Who did they drop the ball on? All that and more. Still to come. It is the Law running down the worst of 2012 in wrestling and MMA right here on TSN Radio 1050 and the Team 1410 Vancouver. Right here, we still know.
What's going on? This is Nate Newton, better known as the Godfather, TNA. I'm probably on hold right now waiting to chat. And if you like my phone calls on the Law, then you'll love Review and Impact. Every Friday at LiveAudioWrestling.com, it's John Pollock, Wai Ting, and myself chatting Impact Wrestling. The good, the bad, and the influence of Bruce Prichard. So tune in every Friday morning at LiveAudioWrestling.com, iTunes, or get the free Stitcher app. It's a guaranteed 6 out of 10.
You're listening to Live Audio Wrestling.
You listen to me and do what I say. My word is the Law.
On TSN Radio.
My name's Claire Lynch. You don't know me, and Dixie and AJ, we're hoping they could keep it that Wai. Dixie and AJ are not having an affair. I'm an addict. I've been trying to get clean. I started out drinking and I just got out of control.
We have to listen to this whole thing?
I do pills.
It hurts.
Got so bad that I take money from my family.
Oh, no.
That's why I couldn't come to them to help.
Back
I woke
to
up a couple
pie.
Times in a hotel
Back
with a stranger.
To the Popeye ride.
I'm so sorry.
I'm sorry, too. Sorry that we all
You finally did the real Static song.
Yeah. Gotta save it for the big, big time.
Yay! Welcome back. That was just Claire. Terrible, terrible memories.
We're here to purify everyone.
Oh, my goodness.
This was like therapy for me, absolutely.
The Claire Lynch angle from TNA Wrestling, one of the lowlights this year for sure. Welcome back. The Law Live Audio Wrestling, TSN 1050 Toronto, running down the worst of 2012. So let's get back into our categories, guys. We are getting into the worst gimmick of the year. Dan Lovranski.
I could see a sweep in this one, too, actually, just because it was such a blatant ripoff of a popular television show, and it has gone absolutely nowhere since it started, and it just gets more and more frustrating week after week, and that's Aces and Eights.
Aces and Eights for Dan. Yep. John?
I'm going a different direction. Three-hour Raws.
These are
Wai too painful for me. I'll take Aces and Eights anytime over these three-hour Raws, which every week are a struggle.
That is tough. Wai?
Perhaps the hardest category to pick, honestly, because, I mean,
there's lots to choose from.
I echo Mout's statements earlier on the show about Tenside. Just, you know, a terrible, just that, what the hell? He had a finisher where he spits into his hand,
yeah.
And he puts the claw of the guy with his mitt. But my worst angle, or worst gimmick of the year has to be Natalia the Farter.
That was awful.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely awful.
Like, what? Yep. Why is this on my TV?
Absolutely awful.
You probably don't like this person very much, whoever came up with it, but to embarrass somebody like this in a national TV.
Ridiculous.
Terrible.
Someone watched Wrestling with Shadows, where the kids were teased and called Heart Fart when they were children.
No, jeez. That's a good one.
Thankfully, that one only lasted a couple of weeks. Like, even they, I think they realized. I agree with
but
you,
But the
Wade.
Stench is still
Well,
felt.
That's it. It's still hanging in the air.
I have two. I couldn't decide here. Number one, the Jeff Hardy internal monologues.
Yes, yes.
Are just ridiculous.
Well, to the point that Austin Aries made fun of it on TN on Impact a couple weeks ago. He goes, "Oh, what? You can't hear the thoughts inside my head?" And all
oh,
that.
Like, I didn't notice that.
He actually made fun of it. That's how bad it was. Yeah.
And the other one, as a complete gimmick, and I think this probably tops it out, is TNA Gut Check. It's a terrible segment.
Yeah.
It's a terrible concept.
And, it's
and they never did anything with it.
Exactly. What new guy has come out of it?
Maybe Joey Ryan.
One guy's come out of it. All the guys that won, we never saw again. And then the one guy that didn't win, we saw for weeks on
They're
end.
Still training, Mouth. I mean, I don't think the Gut Check is ever going to produce any type of main eventer. But, I mean, as a segment themselves,
it will.
I'm entertaining.
It will produce one, and that'll be Joseph Park. They're going to put him in Gut Check. He'll win. And that is, I mean, it doesn't really work, but that actual gimmick will become main event from that, I think. But last year was atrocious. The segments are horrible. The music is terrible. Anyway.
Yeah.
Worst match of the year is where we head to from here. Dan Lovranski.
I went with John Cena versus John Laurinaitis from Over the Limit 2012. Way too much humor in a main event match for my liking. You know, fighting in the commentary booth, putting the headphones on and pretending to do commentary, asking the audience to count to 10. Just end the ending, too, with Big Show, Cork and Cena, and Johnny Ace still winning. I just thought it was a terrible. I don't mind comedy, but I don't want it in the main event, and I don't want it as ridiculous as it was in that match. And it was a bad feud to begin with, too.
That was pretty terrible, John.
Speaking of Gut Check, I went with Chris Louie against Gunner from the August 23rd edition of Impact. I have never seen. I don't think I've ever seen a worse television match that I can recall. Chris Louie was. This was just so comically bad of a guy that could barely just move here. I mean, it was, I got so much enjoyment out of it. I hate to call this a worst match of the year, but that's exactly what it was. Wait.
You stole my pick, John. I thought you guys would forget about it, but yeah, Chris Louie versus a Gunner. Actually, Chris Louie was up for me for candidate for a worst wrestler of the year, but you know, just one performance doesn't really qualify. But man, he was so bad to the point where, like, I remember Pritchard on the next week just basically told him to get out of the business.
And they flew his wife in for the big judgment the next week. I mean, just putting this guy through the pain.
Mm-hmm. I had, I believe, what would have been the lead-up to the Laurinaitis fight, and that was John Cena versus Michael Cole that took place on Raw. And it was either April 6th or June 4th. I don't know which one it was because it's 06, 04, 2012. Yeah, it was. There was a fire extinguisher involved. There was, I think, the barbecue sauce at the end of it for JR. And
right.
So I just hated every second of it. Just terrible. Honorable mention to Matt Morgan versus Crimson, which we watched at your place, Mouth.
Yes.
And I just remember them both being blown up after 5 minutes in that match.
Terrible match.
That was at lockdown.
Yes.
Worst feud of the year. Now, feud and gimmick and angle, they all, I think we find places
kind of,
to slot in what we want
here.
Yeah,
this is one of those ones where you can work the stats to your liking. I went with what I just talked about, Cena versus, I mean, honorable mention to Aces and Eights versus TNA, because I hate it, and it's going nowhere. But Cena versus Laurinaitis wins out for me. I just thought it was ridiculous. Feuds with wrestlers and authority figures very often, well, they never work, and they never lead to proper matches, and this one led to great stuff like, Cena against Cole, Cena against Laurinaitis, to quote Shiki Hoktu.
Yes, indeed. John?
I did go with Aces and Eights against TNA. It's just a
terrible.
Horrible spotlight over top of all of TNA programming. I don't see any kind of payoff that warrants this kind of television time, and it's just brought so much down. And as we mentioned, TNA had so much momentum going into this summer, and Aces and Eights just popped the balloon of whatever momentum they had.
Way.
FX Canada has been airing Sons of Anarchy marathons all week, and I had my first glimpse of Sons of Anarchy, and it just made me more appalled at Nate's gimmick. Everything down to the vests, yep. A direct ripoff.
Well, I think the obvious logo. One was when they did the poster for the TNA sure. pay-per-view, and you went and looked at the cover of the DVD of Sons of Anarchy, and they were exactly the same.
And I would understand some type of, I don't know, a tribute, but no, I don't understand it, because, like, why would you do this? Robbie E., it makes sense, because he's a comedy character, but, I mean, if you're top villains to much.
The idea is for you take from popular culture and you weave it into the program, but you don't blatantly steal outright like that is.
And when you just look at it, like, where are we? How long have they been around?
Oh, I don't know.
Just since the summer. Time.
6 months. Like 6 months.
Where are we right
nowhere.
Now?
Exactly.
We nowhere.
Exactly.
We all know
we're spinning our wheels from
got a
day
group
one.
With D-Von as the leader.
Yeah, and Luke Gallows. And, not looking good.
I picked that one as well. Aces and Eights versus TNA for all those reasons. This is an interesting category every year. They really drop the ball on... ... Fill in the blank. Mouth.
I don't know. We could see a sweep here. I don't know. I'm going with Brock Lesnar. I just think, they should have worked out a better deal with him and got more dates with him. And that first match with Cena, as great as it was, and I know some people are going to pick it as their match of the year.
I did.
I'm sorry, the finish just takes that right out for me. And the fact that he did not win that first match, to me, totally is dropping the ball with Brock. And he could have been so much bigger right now. All we have to look forward to is him and Triple H. And I can't say I'm excited about that. Whereas if he had come in, tore through some top guys in the roster, then Triple H maybe has to come back to fight him. I might have been a little bit more interested, but I really think they dropped the ball on Brock. I think they wasted him all year.
John.
I went with a James Storm at Lockdown. They had built this up for months and months, finally facing Bobby Roode in his hometown, no less, and they book him to fail.
Absolutely.
And I don't think James Storm has ever recovered. They put him over. He was the point leader for the majority of the Bound for Glory series. Then he failed at that to get to the finals. And I just, to me, he's on the show right now, but I just think, first of all, that crowd was dead that night in Nashville, but just the booking of it where they had built this up and then they changed their mind at the last minute, I just think it did so much damage to this
terrible.
Guy as a potential big baby face.
Where was the ball dropped for you, Wai Ting?
I'm going to go with MMA here and talk about Zuffa's mismanagement of Strikeforce. You know, at the beginning of the year, I think they're, you know, it's pretty clear that, you know, they're pretty much taking what they wanted from Strikeforce, and Strikeforce was eventually going to die. But nonetheless, you had a really good commodity here with, national TV on Showtime. And a number of still remaining great fighters on their rosters. And I think, you can chalk it up to the injuries as well. Certainly that didn't help. But just the overall, the potential of Strikeforce, I think, was still very much there. And it was just completely squandered by now.
I agree with Mouth on this one. I have gone with Brock Lesnar as well. I think that there was big money to be made here,
totally.
And it will no longer be made because of what they did to that angle. Let's go with a different angle here, and that is worst angle of the year, Mouth.
Well, lots to choose from. I got a couple of honorable mentions here. Hornswoggle as the Raw Anonymous GM.
Oh, yeah! Brilliant. You're absolutely right. That was just horrific.
That sucked. I also honorable mention to the Claire Lynch pregnancy angle.
Yes.
I'm not going to go with that, though. I'm going with exploiting Jerry Lawler's heart attack. I think was just not very tasteful. And here's a guy, you know, could have died on your TV. And I know everything turned out well, but I just thought we heard about it too much afterwards. And too much footage slowed down and turned up the breathing and just trying to make it was... exploitation at its finest. So that's despite the fact that I hated the Claire Lynch, I picked Jerry Lawler's heart attack.
My honorable mention goes to all the garbage that we've somewhat forgotten from the early part of the year involving John Cena, Kane, Zack Ryder, and Eve Torres, everything involving all that. It was just horrendous television every week, but I did go with the Claire Lynch reveal as this junkie that Dixie Carter was secretly helping by not telling her husband about helping her, and it led to this affair where, if you remember, Surge decked AJ Styles. Horrendous from start to finish.
Wai Ting.
I also have to go with Claire Lynch. And, not, you know, even to add to that, the angle really extends even further back before when Daniels and AJ were feuding and Kazarian was originally against it, and eventually it became a part of it, helping Daniels because of Stockholm Syndrome.
Yeah, he was kidding.
Right.
Yeah. Just the whole thing was just, it's just been so weird, and it ended terribly. So, yes, the Claire Lynch angle is my worst angle of the year.
Claire Lynch debacle tops my list as well for this category. Let's go to worst pay-per-view of the year for professional wrestling. Mouth.
Okay, now a couple of you guys have touched on this, but this is where I get my digs in on this one, something John talked about. I picked TNA Lockdown. Used to be one of, there was a real run there for 2 or 3 years where it was one of the best shows.
Yes.
They did every single year. We really looked forward to it. This year, I don't know if you guys remember the actual pay-per-view, but
Memphis.
The crowd was dead. The crowd was dead the entire time. And as John mentioned, this was the show that was supposed to launch Storm, give him the big title reign, and then allegedly Hogan said, "No way, brother," and they put it on Rude, and they made Storm look like a dork, and now he's just another guy on the roster. And plus, I guess one of you other guys also mentioned it, it had Crimson versus Morgan on it.
That was me. Yep,
yeah,
that was one of my worst of the
year. So I picked TNA Lockdown.
Yep, John.
And I co-signed that choice. Lockdown.
Ooh.
2012. The crowd that night was
terrible.
Just, you could hear a pin
dead.
Drop.
Exactly. Super
it was
dead.
Terrible. And I think it was just a terrible way of booking James Storm.
Now, I picked that as well. Wai Ting, is this a clean sweep?
I don't even know if I watched it.
That's true, yeah. You didn't.
And if you had,
it would have been.
Yeah, I don't think it'd be fair for me to choose here because if it was that bad, I probably didn't watch it.
Yeah. Okay, well, Wai's leaving that one blank,
he's
though.
He's taking it by default.
It's like the book category.
Yeah, and that's coming up. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to try to run through our last six categories. The book's in there, TV show, promotion, all that stuff coming up. As the Law continues on with our worst of 2012 in the world of wrestling and MMA. Right here on TSN 1050 Toronto and the team 1410 Vancouver.
Melrose Place.
Cheers.
Dallas.
MASH.
Dallas.
The Surf.
What do all these shows have in common, Wai?
They're on TV.
They all pale in comparison to Raw, which is a weekly 3-hour show, meaning, Wai, we have even more to talk about every Monday night on Review of Raw at liveaudiowrestling.com.
That's great.
Tune in, folks, every Monday night, also on iTunes.
I can't stand it. I can't stand it, Eve. The hate. It's pouring out of my soul. John Cena is starting to embrace the hate. He's not all the way there yet. When Cena finally embraces the hate, he'll be in a better place. But if he doesn't get there soon, I'm afraid for you, Eve. For the first time in my life, I am afraid of me.
I forgot about all that crap.
I relived it today.
It was so bad.
It went on for like 2 months.
Oh, yeah, it was bad.
There was an ambulance match at the Rumble. No contest, no less, in an ambulance match.
Wow.
Kane's goal was for Cena to embrace the hate.
That's right.
Yeah. That was the whole thing.
So ridiculous.
Yeah, it was
threw
terrible.
Zack Ryder off the stage. He tombstoned him into hell.
Essentially, that killed Zack Ryder, too, who was really hot at that point and just absolutely destroyed
his character.
Eve
all year.
And Ryder really, that was poison to a character that was very hot.
Yeah.
Welcome back to the Lots Live Audio Wrestling. We're doing our worst of 2012 special for wrestling and mixed martial arts in studio. Dan Lovranski, John Pollock, Wai Ting, myself, Jason Agnew. So let's get back to it. A few more minutes here, then we're going to complete it after the 1 a.m. hour passes. Worst pay-per-view of the year for mixed martial arts.
Right. We just did wrestling, so MMA. I'm going with UFC 149.
This could be a sweep.
Yeah?
I think so.
The one from Calgary. I mean, did any of the matches actually play out on that show?
Well, John, did you pick this as well? Because this was a poison card right from the very beginning.
Well, yeah,
I did. There were tons of fights. I don't know the exact number here of the changes, but it went through a ton of changes here. The funny part is the undercard was
excellent.
Really great, but the pay-per-view portion,
right.
I mean, a decent opener, but then from there, there. We had James Head and Brian Ebersole. It was bad. Congo and Jordan was just atrociously bad. And then we got that horrendous fight with Tim Boach and Hector Lombard.
That's so the one I remember. That
it was my pick as well.
And, you know, the unfortunate thing with this, I picked it as well. And Faber and Brower were on top. And it's not. It wasn't necessarily a bad fight, but the crowd had
the crowd was not
so
ready for
fights.
A five-round fight after seeing those last 2 to 3 fights prior.
Just terrible. And the unfortunate thing also, I mean, they had a crowd that was pretty full. They were at the Saddle Dome in Calgary for the first time, so novelty followed the UFC there. However, kind of leaving a bad taste in the mouth.
That's the thing. That's the other thing about it is why I picked it, because it was such an important first-time card there, and it didn't turn out to be what you'd want for a first-time show.
Wait, what did you pick for this?
Sweet.
Clean sweep. UFC 149 is the worst of the year. And really, I don't think it was necessarily the UFC's fault. It was just a lot of injuries, and this one just took it on the nose, unfortunately. You know, the undercard was excellent. I think it was probably the best undercard of the year, actually. But unfortunately, just pay-per-view itself, terrible.
Yeah.
Worst promotion of the year, mouth.
I'm going with TNA, just because as I look through my worst of list, they're in 95% of the categories, so I'm going with TNA. It had, and I think partially too, just because they had that brief moment where it was kind of, it looked like they were kind of going to get it together, going to get behind James Storm, put the push on him, and
then that aces and eights happened.
Right, that was like you say, there's that 3 month period where it was kind of cool, and then the pregnancy thing happened, and then aces and eights right afterwards, and then it just slowly descended down to the outhouse.
Yeah, because of that 3 months, I can't give them this year. John, who are you picking?
I went with Strikeforce. Yeah. I think that this year, I mean, you could classify the way this promotion was run this year as just borderline unprofessional. There were two cards canceled. No one even cared when they were canceled. It was just guys were not getting fights. No one knew what was happening. It was just a complete, like, deadbeat of a promotion this year, and it's just limping its way to death on January 12th.
Now, Wai, you actually had Strikeforce picked as your choice of they really dropped the ball on. Did you choose it as worst promotion as well?
Yes, I did. And, you know, when you really look at it, like, you know, what are my choices here? What are the promotions that I watch regularly? There's the WWE, there's TNA. Both have their negative spots, but they both have their bright spots, too. And, you know, UFC certainly does. But when you look at Strikeforce, you see what their output was the year prior compared to this year, only doing a handful of shows. I think the choice is pretty obvious.
I do as well. I think that there was a lot of talent in Strikeforce as well, and they really just let it all go, unfortunately. UFC decided to go in there, and, you know, I think it started with Nick Diaz when they pulled Diaz away, and that wasn't even this year, and then it was just really abused this year, and it's unfortunate because, you know, as you mentioned, Wai, in your pick, for they really dropped the ball, and they had a great TV deal. It's hard to get a TV deal. You know, MMA promotions would kill for the TV deal on Showtime. You have great announcers there. I mean, Moro can make an average fight seem Wai above average, and they just drove this promotion into the ground. Even if they had made it a feeder system, I think it would have been a better thing to do than what they've done with Strikeforce. So it'll be interesting to see whether Showtime still continues on and gets back into the MMA game as Strikeforce collapses at the end of this month. We have 3 more categories to do. We're going to bump Dave Meltzer down a little bit, put him at the next quarter hour, but when we come back, we got worst book, worst DVD, and worst mixed martial artist of the year. As we continue on with the worst of professional wrestling and MMA right here on the Law Live Audio Wrestling, TSN 1050 Toronto, the Team 1410 Vancouver.
If you want interviews with wrestling's hottest stars, behind-the-scenes news, and the most complete wrestling package on the World Wide Web, then you want The Law. No holes barred wrestling radio, coast to coast, with Dan the Most Lovranski and Jason Agnew. Daily updates from The Law's own John Pollock. Plus, uncut, unedited interviews with wrestling's hottest stars and greatest legends. LiveAudioWrestling.com. Log on today. TSN Radio.
It's 100% entertainment, 100% electricity, 100%
The Law.
I think that Czech Congo and Jordan pushed against the fence for 3 rounds, and I think that the ref let them do it. I mean, when you see these guys that are in a clinch, this is the ultimate clinching championship. It's the fighting championship. And when you see 2 guys just clinching for 3 rounds, and then in the 3rd round they clinched for an entire 5 minutes, and this idiot standing around looking at him. As a referee, your job is to enforce the rules and make sure that these guys fight. Yves Levine was horrendous. horrendous tonight. We broke the gate record here tonight, and I'm embarrassed.
Welcome back to it. It's the Law Live on Air Wrestling, talking about the worst of 2012 in the world of professional wrestling and mixed martial arts. And that was Dana White commenting on the Sean Jordan and Chet Congo fight that came from UFC 149 that took place in Calgary, hence the Bret Hart music.
And Brad getting the biggest pop on that show.
He did. Yeah. Just a cutaway to Brad got the biggest pop of the night.
I believe it was right after the Congo fight they cut over to Bret.
Why don't we skip down to that then, since we're in that mindset, and go to the worst MMA fight of the year and do that category instead there. Mouth?
Yeah, it was tough because there was a lot of really good fights this year, but I went with Clay Guida versus Maynard from July.
We were there.
Yeah, that's just, you know, Guida usually, you know, totally exciting fighter, someone that you really want, usually, like, just dives right in there, and this, he did the exact opposite of this way. A weird split decision on this one, too, which I thought was kind of bizarre. And then, of course, it was put on TV. This was on the UFC on FX4 show, and they put it on TV specifically because they thought it was going to be an exciting fight.
Yep.
That's going to draw in some new viewers, and it was almost as bad as Severn versus Shamrock. I won't say it was quite as bad as that, but very, very boring fight, and not what you'd want to see out of Clay Guida, that's for sure.
John Pollock.
I went with the clinch fest between Chet Congo and Sean Jordan from UFC 149. A horrendous fight, rivaled only by that Tim Boach Hector Lombard fight on the same card.
Oh, yes, that was terrible as well. Way.
My pick as well, exactly for the reasons Uncle Dana mentioned, and just the epitome of. I don't know, a fighter winning on points. I mean, Chuck Congo, I think, had every opportunity to just really attack more, but instead it was just a fight, struggle to press up against the cage. Just very frustrating to watch as a viewer.
I went with UFC on FX4 as well, the Clay Guida versus Gray Maynard fight. I went to Atlantic City to see this card. I don't get to go see many live events, but John and I made the plan to go there because, hey, I want to check out Atlantic City too. It's an FX card. It's got a great main event.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not so much. What a disappointment it was. From there, let's do worst mixed martial artists here at this point. Mouth.
Well, there was definitely a few to pick this year. Honorable mentions to Mayhem Miller and Alistair Overeem, but I went with Quentin Jackson.
Ooh, interesting.
Because he had one fight this year.
Yeah, Overeem, he didn't even fight this year.
Well, that's
because
true.
He missed the whole year.
There you go. And Quentin Jackson, just because he had one fight, he did poorly in it, the fight with Ryan Bader. And just all the crazy stuff with this year, I'm quitting, oh, I'm staying, I'm quitting, I'm staying. No one seems to know what's going on. Is he even fighting? He's fighting in January,
yep,
is he?
Yep, Glover Teixeira.
So far, okay, keep our fingers crossed. I don't know. So I picked Quentin, too, because he's one of those guys that's almost like the face, one of the faces of UFC, and he was such a good character for the early days and a spectacular fighter and just had a terrible year, I thought.
John.
I went with Bob Sapp, and it's not even so much. I mean, he's just become such a parody of himself at this point. He only fought twice this year. He actually did win a fight, which is noteworthy in and of itself. But he's just, I mean, this was a guy who, on New Year's Eve back in 2003, drew 53 million people to watch him and Aki Bono. He was just on top of the world in K1 and then with Pride as well. And today, it's just like he goes into these fights. He openly admits it's a cash grab where anytime there's any kind of problem, boom, he taps out. He had just the most embarrassing interview ever with Ariel Helwani on his radio program earlier this year where he was like in this weird character. It was just painful to listen to, and he's just become just such a comic side note to MMA, and he was someone that was a gigantic pioneer at one point and helped lead the whole surge in Japan once upon a time a decade ago.
That's a very good choice.
Wai Ting.
But my choice would have to be Jason Lucky Patrick Miller.
You know, another painful interview on air.
Yes,
program.
Yeah, I mean, I'll say.
Ran out of the studio.
Yeah, that was crazy.
He had that, unfortunate loss to CB Dolloway at UFC 146, and then afterwards declared his retirement. But it was the way he just descended afterwards that really, stands out. He was arrested
in
the church for being naked. That was weird. Then he went on Helwani's show and to talk about it and just
wouldn't break character.
Yeah.
just stormed out of the building, and just like Helwani, who's a friend of his, wrote his visa application to come into America, and just a very uncomfortable moment on air. He had a bit of redemption when he did that, you know, chat for afterwards with Helwani through Central Park, where you got to see a bit more of an explanation.
Yep.
But still, a real descent in his career over the past year.
Yeah, I can't disagree with that. Jason Mayhem Miller is my choice as well for Worst MMA Fighter of the Year. Let's go to Worst TV Show. We sit through a lot every single week here covering stuff. Mouth.
I believe John covered this in Worst Gimmick, but I'm going to cover it in Worst TV Show, Raw.
Raw, because it's 3 hours.
Absolutely, man. The three-hour thing has not helped at all. The only good thing is every once in a while they give it some of the matches a little bit more time, which I enjoy, but they don't seem to do it enough. They seem to just recap over recap over recap, or explain to us how to use this new app on our computers or our phones. On that Slammy show, that was the most annoying, ridiculous, and they wouldn't be able to do these things if the show wasn't 3 hours. So I'm going with Raw with honorable mention to SmackDown, because SmackDown to me used to be a great show. I used to defend it constantly, but it really has turned into the you don't really even need to watch.
It's been really hurt by the 3 hour.
It is. It's hurting big time, and there's nothing unique about it anymore at all, because the guys just blend together on the two shows. So Raw wins and SmackDown gets the honorable mention.
John.
I actually went the MMA direction and went with the live season of The Ultimate Fighter this year. You know, in practice, sure, let's go live. It sounded like it was reinvigorating the show, but in execution, it was just a complete failure. You weren't able to focus on any of the feuds or any of the personalities because you were basically going from week to week. You didn't know who was going to be advancing and who you could focus on by having a show in the can and then kind of booking backwards, so to speak, if you're the producers. And to me, it didn't really create any compelling characters. We haven't seen the winner, Michael Chiesa, even fight as of now, and I think it's going to be the least remembered season in quite some time. And I enjoyed 16 a lot more when they went back to the tape format and at least learned from the mistake that was the live version.
Wai.
I went with Raw as well, and simply because, you know, as much as I might complain about TNA sometimes, I never feel like it is as much of a chore to watch as those three-hour shows. And thank God for my DVR, because I don't know how I'd be able to get through those shows every week. And, you know, really, just at a time right now when I think an extra hour of content is the last thing this company needs, the last thing that the wrestling industry really needs.
Yep.
And for them to simply do it out of some type of a business deal to make us all suffer, I think a terrible choice.
I chose SmackDown because there's no use for this show anymore.
Yeah.
Raw, at least developments happen, and I could not stand it without a PVR. I couldn't stand any wrestling without a PVR, actually. But SmackDown, just no reason. Let's go to Worst Book. Mouth.
The King of New Orleans, How the Junkyard Dog Became Pro Wrestling's First Black Superstar. It was by Greg Klein. The guy had no information at all. The guy did no research. And he basically talked more about Bill Watts trying to find a new Junkyard Dog after Junkyard Dog left to go to the WWF. A terrible book. Appalling. Don't read it.
In a unique trivia note, I received my best book and worst book of the year in the same package from ECW Press this past summer. I got the Shooter's book, and then I read it, loved it, and dove into this next book because I thought there'd be so much great crossover, and that was with Physical Chess by Billy Robertson, a noted shooter coming out of England in his time in the AWA. I just thought this has the potential to be a great book. First of all, it was like super thin, so I got by it in no time. Just coming up with preposterous stories about how wrestling, yes, it eventually became worked, but it was all based on they would have shoot matches in the gym, and then they would take the legitimate result on the road and replicate the shoot. It was like this guy who would not let go of what wrestling was, not really understanding what his audience was. He's also involved with some guys now in MMA. He trains with the likes of Carl Parisian, and is one of those guys where it's just, well, back in my day, none of these guys would be able to compete with my generation, just the like get off my lawn kind of attitude. And to me, it's like, if you're gonna this to me was just a cash grab here. You got a book deal and it was horrendous, and it had the potential to be great, and it was just a waste of time. Do not buy Physical Chess.
And Wai and I do not read. So we will move on. We will move on to the next category, and that is worst DVD. I'm going first here because I was actually offended at this. Brock Lesnar, Here Comes the Pain, called the Collector's Edition. It's a reissue from something they put out when Lesnar was in the organization before. They added one extra feature of Lesnar coming back on Raw, and they marketed it like it was a new DVD, in my opinion. This was total garbage.
I agree. That's a great pick. I went with Rock versus Cena, Once in a Lifetime. It was because A, it's not going to be Once in a Lifetime, and it was ridiculous. It was just all the stuff leading up into that and the match at Mania. I thought it was. You didn't need it, I didn't think.
I kind of went a different route here because there was a Friday night. I was home by myself, and I ordered...
Oh, China.
I thought both those two would pick China. Since the entertainment I got out of that through Wai Ting, I could not give that my worst DVD. But no, I went with the Vince Russo live U-shoot from a convention. I don't know why I ordered this. It was Vince Russo in his glory here. Just nothing was his fault. He could turn the wrestling industry around. It was just a terrible waste of my own money and a very sad regret on my cable bill.
Wait, DVD.
I didn't know that was a choice. So that is going to be my choice. China, Queen of the Ring. The worst.
Oh, yeah.
One of the worst.
Wei got choked up, actually, during that
Yes.
One.
China got choked up, too.
I was going to say, interesting choice of words there.
One of the worst visual experiences I've ever had in my
Everyone
life.
Everyone dropped the ball on her in that one.
Oh. Yeah. Ball. Okay. More yes. than, never mind.
Like testicles.
Yeah.
Finish your thought.
That was it.
Okay.
No more thought.
It's finished.
Our final category of the year is a fun one, WTF moment of the year. Mouth?
Well, this one, I judge it by actually uttering that phrase.
Yeah, you say it a lot.
Exactly. But this time I think I said it during the entire finish of the match, to you guys the entire time before the show started, and probably the entire time after the show ended, went Lesnar beating John Cena in that match. Just the match was so well done with all the shoot stuff, busting him open hard way, real drama to the match, incredibly captivating, and then blew it all on the finish. I hated it. I was totally like, yeah, what the...
I couldn't even fathom them going this direction in his very first match, and you can just look at what could have been gained with Lesnar versus what was gained by John Cena winning this. This was just another match, and the storyline going into this new year and this potential rematch is that John Cena is coming off the worst year of his career. This didn't even service that whole narrative that they're trying to explain now. So just mind-boggling that they would spend this money and beat him on night one, where this could have been all year long, who can beat this man that's running roughshod in this company, and we answered the question on night one.
So that is yours as well, then?
Oh, yes.
Yes. Wei?
For me, it was really a collection of moments, and that was really due to all the cancellations and injuries that have come to the UFC and Zuffa as a whole over the past year. I mean, just... The unimaginable, really. Like, you know, so many main events getting shuffled around. Everything from John Jones getting injured to even, like, Jeremy Stevens getting arrested on the night of his fight.
Yeah.
I mean, tough seasons with, like, Dominic Cruz, Shane Carwin, and Vitor Belfort all getting canceled after the fact. It's just amazing that this company came out as relatively successful as they did despite all this.
Mine was, I mean, the peculiar moment where I was saying it almost inquisitively was Jerry Lawler's live heart attack on TV, which was just an insane moment to watch. But I can't believe it hasn't come up tonight. Hulk Hogan sex tape is mine, where it was like...
That
Hulk
was going to be my best angle of the year.
Well, it could have been, yeah.
To television.
It's like Hogan's sex tape, then Bubba's involved, then it's with Bubba's wife, then it's like, then it gets... I still think it was all cleverly planned, but that's what I set it for this year. And that wraps it up. Those are all our categories, guys. So we are going to come back, and we're going to chat with Dave Meltzer from the Wrestling Observer Newsletter, and then after that, we're going to open up the phone lines and take some of your phone calls in regards to what you thought was bad this year in the world of pro wrestling and MMA. It's The Law, live audio wrestling, TSN 1050 Toronto, the Team 1410 Vancouver. I could escape this feeling. It's time! It's time! Time to play the game.
It's time for the Wrestling Observer Extra.
Wrestling Observer Extra.
With Dave Meltzer.
Back by popular demand.
Right here on The Law. Live audio wrestling.
All right, so we always get carried away with our worst of 2012 episode that we do. So we're deep into the show here before we manage to get Dave Meltzer on the line. And but that is indeed our theme tonight, Dave Meltzer. It's our worst of 2012 show. So rather than throwing specific categories at you, you know, when you think back to the year, Dave, what pops out as some of the worst moments of the year in pro wrestling and MMA?
Boy, that's hard.
Yeah, there's so much
to choose from, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, nothing, it's nothing really, I don't know. I don't know if anything like, really stands out that bad. I mean, there's, I don't know. you got me kind of stumped.
I'm surprised. I mean, for us, it was just automatic, like, you know Claire Lynch,
Aces and Eights.
Claire Lynch was a good idea that got really bad. I think it started out like pretty good, and then it just like, yeah, that, you know, I think Aces and Eights started out bad from the beginning and they just keep going with it. I mean, it doesn't interest me at all.
The unfortunate thing with that is there's no, you know, real end in sight. It just keeps going.
I know. And the other thing is that with Claire Lynch, it was like a side angle, whereas the Aces and Eight is like the main angle of the show.
Mm-hmm.
So it it's like Claire Lynch was one segment of a show. So if you didn't like it, there were like, you know, seven other segments on the show. This one, it's like, it's the overriding one. And so, yeah, that was pretty bad. There was one thing WWE did, I'm trying to remember what it is, where I just thought it was like, but it's not getting in my head for some reason.
Hornswoggle was the anonymous GM.
The anonymous GM never, like, got me mad or anything. It was just kind of, like, stupid. And then when they finally revealed it, it was, you know, what a bad reveal, right?
Yeah,
it was terrible. All right, well, let's touch on a few news topics then, Dave. Ric Flair this week talked about the fact that he does want to wrestle again. You know, it looks like his affiliation is...
Well, you knew that.
Yeah. Well, of course he does. But, I mean, you know, one of the big stories of 2012 was that, you know, Jerry Lawler, a heart attack on live TV, of course. You know, Flair's up at that same age. Will WWE even let him do this? I mean, first night back, he was in the ring.
Yeah, you know, we talked about that. That was the strangest thing in the world because, like when they started talking to him a month before, you know, he's debuted or whatever it was, 5 weeks before, they told him in no uncertain terms, you know, we'll take you back, we want you on TV, but you're not getting in the ring, and don't even bring it up to anybody. Don't talk to anybody. If we, you know, that's got to be your deal. Deal? Okay, and it's like, okay, yeah, deal. And he was told people, he's like, I'm not going to wrestle, you know, that's the deal. And then he shows up and says, hey, do you want to do some physicality?
Of course,
and with no warning, and it's like, oh, do I, right?
Yeah.
Hey, can I even do a match? You know, so I know All Japan wants him to do a match real bad. And I mean, they did in September as well, and I think that whenever their next Sumo Hall show is, they want him real bad. I can't imagine, I just don't see WWE putting him in a match. Now, as far as letting him do physicality, I think that they're going to put him through all kinds of tests, and if he passed the tests, I think that they might do it. Yet I'm actually surprised because of what happened to Lawler and what happened to Steamboat.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, I mean, it's not just one. It's if it was just one, you could just say and you know, no, he's not Lawler, and no, he's not Steamboat. But I think that there's a lesson there. And I know Rick's an Iron Man and all that. But you know, I don't know. It's like he wants it and. I mean, but will they let him do physicality? Yeah, they already did.
Yeah.
So I guess that he may do that. But I don't see him doing a match just because I don't think that they want to go back on that WrestleMania step.
Yeah. Well, speaking of the Hall of Famer, Ric Flair, and Steamboat in that, we heard the Hall of Fame tickets went on sale this week without any announcing of inductees. The ticket sales did very good. Have you heard any rumblings on who's going in? And have you heard anything on the Bruno front with this?
There's nothing new on the Bruno front, at least as of a couple of days ago. I think it's something that they're going to revisit very, very soon,
like
in the next week or two, I'm thinking. And it'll happen or, you know, like it'll happen or it won't. I mean, as far as names, you know, I mean, this names that everyone talks about, you know, Foley and Nash, you know, maybe Bob Backlund, Ultimate Warrior. I'm sure those are all different guys that are being batted around. Those are the obvious, like, main guys. And, you know, as far as underneath guys, I mean, you know, it can, you know, it can be Coco Ware, it can be anyone.
Yeah, it really doesn't matter.
Yeah, it does. You know, so you know, and everyone's going to remember the key guys and all that. And I think that, you know, those would be probably You know, this was the Freebirds, right?
How
come they didn't go in when they were in Atlanta a couple of years ago?
We just saw Steve Lombardi on TV a couple of weeks ago. He's going in this year.
Yeah, there is speculation of that, definitely.
They're in New York?
Yeah.
He's been with the company forever. 25, 30 years.
Yeah.
As referenced on all those DVDs. Dave, it was a quick one this week. We do have to say goodbye. But Observer, quickly, what are the features this week?
I'm going to write about Cain Velasquez. I really want to do a preview of the wrestling for next year. That's kind of like my goal, to try to get that in this issue. And then covering just all of the weekend material and everything. And, so that's kind of the stuff, kind of looking back at the UFC World Heavyweight Championship from start to finish.
Oh, amazing.
Something in that regard as well.
Very cool. Look forward to that. Thank you very much for joining us, and we'll talk to you again. We'll be on time next week. I swear, Dave. It's not a special. We'll be on time. Thank you very much. That's Dave Meltzer. You can find him at WrestlingObserver.com podcast. And, of course, you can subscribe to the actual Wrestling Observer newsletter there as well. When we come back, time for you guys to call on in. 416-870-1050, 1-855-591-6876. Share with us your worst of 2012 in the world of wrestling and MMA on the law, live audio wrestling.
Friday nights, TSN Radio has your cage side tickets.
Hey everyone, it's John Pollock here from the MMA Report on Friday nights at 11 p.m. Eastern. Tune in every Friday as I get you set for every major mixed martial arts card from the UFC, Strikeforce, Bellator, and every other organization under the sun. Plus, your chance to hear Pollock's picks. It's the MMA Report Friday nights at 11 p.m. Eastern.
The MMA Report with John Pollock. Friday nights at 11 on TSN 1050 Toronto.
You're listening to Live Audio Wrestling.
Let's take a walk on the wild side. And as the ladies say, doo-doo, doo-doo-doo.
On TSN Radio.
I want you to pick two of your toughest guys. Two guys that are part of your brotherhood. To step into the ring with two guys from our brotherhood, because I don't think you really know what brotherhood is all about. This is about you watching what happens when you mess with us. You standing by helpless, watching two of your toughest guys get destroyed by two of ours. And then knowing that it's all because of you.
Amazing! All right, John, tell the story, because I know that voice.
No, I can't take any credit for this. Right after this promo aired a couple of months ago, people online changed the audio, and it revealed that it was, in fact, Eric Bischoff, who is doing the voice of the voiceless.
Yeah, of the Aces and Eights crap. Welcome back to it. It's the Law Live Audio Wrestling. We're talking about the worst of 2012. Okay, guys, here's the deal. We're going to the phones now, but I don't need you to run down your entire list.
That is what the message board is now for.
Yeah. If you agree with us, great. Just pick a couple categories that maybe we didn't cover. You know, like when Mouth talked about Hornswoggle, no one remembered that, and that was a great point. So pick something that's a great point here, okay? That's what we're doing here with the phones. Okay, Wai, let's do this.
Don't make him angry.
Let's go to line two. Mike is in Mississauga.
Hi, Mike. Welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks, guys, for making my week enjoyable.
Great.
I have a couple of things. First, an awfully bad thing for them is WWE.com. They're spoiling their own results. They just tell me that Wade Barrett wins the Intercontinental Championship tonight on Raw. Why would I tune in now? I have no reason to turn in anyway. Now I'm not going to.
Maybe that was trying to do it like with Mick Foley when Tony Schiavone revealed
this
it.
This is not Mick Foley
winning
the WWE title.
I think it's just in this day and age they know it's going to get out anyway, so they want to be the first to get it out. So I think that's why nowadays they do stuff like that.
And how about Tensai beating up Sakamoto? Nothing did come of that. He just...
Nope.
Nothing came of Tensai, period.
Nope, not really.
And then he had that tout that they had to take down where he made fun of him for his driving ability of an Asian driver.
Yes. Yeah, he should have gone with that gimmick. He should have just been the racist.
That would have been great.
That would have been amazing.
No.
I look over to ask for the next call, and Wai is just shaking his head at me.
Not pleased.
Line
one. Ken from Scarborough.
Ken.
I'm back.
Excited.
We don't have any tickets for you to sell, Ken.
No. Well, first of all, theme song has to be SummerSlam. Kevin Rudolph, Overkill, plus having him come on SummerSlam this year and do an absolutely horrendous performance.
Oh, yeah, that was terrible. That was a really low point of SummerSlam.
And another thing, if you're going to bring in all of these superstars that do their performance, why are you going to bring them on to perform their song and then have their interest theme come on, like WrestleMania? Remember how I was all about that, but never mind it. I got a special award for Sin Cara, the Golden Botulism Award, because it seems like every time he went out there to perform on Raw or on SmackDown, he seemed to botch something.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting with the Sin Cara because they had the lights and they didn't have the lights, so they brought the lights back, and it's just, this is not, he's not transferring well to the North American style.
No, he's had a rough time of it since day one. I mean, he came in, he had trouble working the style, he gets hurt.
I think he was starting to gel with Rey. I think that was a good use of him, putting him in a tag team where people got into it, but unfortunately, Rey has had out of the ring issues, and that's kind of left Sin Cara on his own now. He, I believe, was back at the tapings last night.
I expect those two to stay together for hopefully the majority of 2013. Because that's the only way Sin Cara is getting over, is with the Rey rub, and then eventually doing a feud at the end of it.
Is Rey still here a year from now?
Yeah, that's...
I could see him being done after maybe.
Yeah, because Rey's hurting big time. That's why I think it's good for him to be in a tag, is that he needs to be working with somebody else. He shouldn't be doing singles matches.
Yep. Wait.
Line three, James is in Chicago.
Hi, James.
Okay. I definitely agree with Mouse. Term that there's a lot of parody booking going on in WWE this year, and I think John Cena was at the center of a lot of it with the Ace feud, with the Ryder angle, with Kane and the AJ feud right now. It's just terrible, and I think that the feud with The Rock was the aftermath of that feud was just left a lot to be desired, because one week he's doing the empty arena promo saying this is the biggest match of his life, and he has to win it. And then the night after, he's smiling about losing to The Rock. So, and then the next month, he's in the match with Brock Lesnar. He gets beat up, and then he's doing a promo about leaving. And then the next night, he says he's not going anywhere.
That was a great point.
It is. It's a typical of what they do.
That was a really weird moment at the end of that when Cena cut that promo. Very strange. And along with that, I find that there's a definite fault in Cena's character about and it also transfers to Sheamus now as well.
Sheamus is quietly getting into that role
into
now
Cena,
where the comedy that they are putting into his scripts that are just, it's so transparent.
Annoying.
Yep, I definitely agree. Wait.
Let's go to Pedro, who is from Barry but is in Florida. You wanted me specifically.
Oh, thank goodness.
Yes.
Where is he, Wai?
Sorry, line five.
Line five. Florida. Hi, Pedro.
Hey, man. What's going on?
Talking wrestling. Worst of.
Oh, it was horrible. You guys talked about Rampage and how bad he is.
Yeah.
I went to Sun and Silva down in Vegas, and we stayed at the MGM where the fight was, right?
Okay.
And it was Friday night, I think.
A lot of traveling this year.
What's that?
Go ahead.
There was a deal in the lobby where they had Bisping and Congo and who else?
And the story involving Jackson was what?
What's that?
What's the story?
Never mind. I don't care. I don't care. Guys, succinct points. Come on.
He's coming back.
Man, what the hell was that? Wai, who's next?
Klein and Markham. Let's go back to Canada.
Okay.
Line six.
Line six.
If we're so inclined.
Hey, Klein.
Hey, what's up, guys?
Chat wrestling. Worst of.
Yeah, you had the best category last week, so I'm going to say the worst comeback this year. And just because it was bad luck, but more City Machine Guns returning in TNA.
Yeah. It was tough. You're right, though. It was bad luck. I mean, it was a lot of injury and such, right?
Yeah.
Chris
Shelly,
Sabin, that was...
Yeah, Shelly was gone in 2 months, and Sabin got injured again.
Yeah.
Really
Shelly's
right?
doing okay right now in New Japan. Yeah. He's hooked up with Kushida, and they've got a good junior heavyweight tag team going. But for Chris Sabin, to be out a year, comes back, and boom, he's out for another year. I mean, you've got a feel for the guy.
Yeah, and I got my WTF moment of the year real quick.
Yep.
CM Punk beating the fan up while Vince was cutting a promo in the ring.
That was one of those
moments.
It was
interesting, definitely.
Yeah, you were going, what's going on here? Yep, that was bizarre.
And you know, really not that much fallout from it. Yeah,
no,
afterwards.
Nothing for Punk, no.
Yeah, and Punk didn't want to talk about it because it came up in future interviews, and he just immediately shot it down. I think he realized, you know, he hit the wrong target here.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. Wait.
Chad is in Illinois on line one.
All right. Hi, Chad. Welcome to our Worst Of show.
Hey, guys. Hey, one thing that I kind of was surprised that didn't get touched on in the Worst Of that hasn't been mentioned yet, at least that I didn't catch yet on this program, is the whole AJ Lee love saga.
There was
a total amount. I mean, with the Clara Lynch stuff, that's going to run away with the awards. But the AJ Lee stuff was pretty horrible. We got some good matches out of it. But that was one thing I was surprised that kind of didn't get any mention on the show. And another thing, to kind of touch off the Observer Awards for most disgusting, what was it?
Promotional tactic.
Yeah, most disgusting promotional tactic. I'm going to give that to the Linda McMahon campaign. Just because it hurt the product so much where they were trying to tone down everything. They removed all the Attitude Era stuff from YouTube. And then they spent $100 million on it for nothing, for garbage. I mean, when guys, I think Roddy Piper even tweeted out, when guys, you know, have to pay for their own hotel room, they don't get insurance, they don't get benefits. And they spend $100 million on pretty much nothing. They just pretty much wipe their ass with it and throw it away. But that's what I got, guys, and I'll hang up and listen in. But thanks for the show. Thanks for everything you guys do. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much for your phone call. The AJ Lee thing is really, you know, terrible because her character has just been all over the map this year. In particular, just the latest little bit where her and Vicky Guerrero are paired together, and I just have no idea how they're making these two work together because you have both are heels, but when they deal with each other, Vicky's a baby face, and that's death.
Well, you didn't see Vicky with them this week.
No, I guess not this week.
No, I think they're done with Vicky. I don't think she's going to be
involved. Once you got AJ out of the GM role, where it wasn't so much of a big focus, like I prefer this role much more where she's just kind of seconding Dolph at this point and not all over the show in multiple segments on her own.
Yeah, I think that, you know, she does play a good crazy, but it's just been too much.
It was too much AJ. Absolutely.
Yeah, too much of a good thing. Wait.
Baroni's in the desert on line four.
All right. Hey, Baroni.
Yo, what's up, guys? How you doing?
Good.
All right. Agnew, did you say that you can't stand to watch wrestling without your DVR?
Absolutely.
Did you watch wrestling as a kid?
Yep. It's totally different.
Completely different.
No way, dude. Watch wrestling, you can only watch it without your DVR.
Can you watch wrestling without your bong, Baroni?
I watch it without it, yes.
I don't know about that.
You got to watch wrestling just like you watch whatever, man. It's just like...
Dude, I don't watch anything without a DVR, Baroni.
Dude, watch wrestling. You host a radio show, a wrestling radio show.
We're still watching all the important parts.
No, I'm not watching it all.
I don't need to watch Michael Cole tell me 5 times in a row how to use some stupid app that I don't even have an appliance to put it on or whatever the hell it's called.
What?
Exactly. That was the old man rambling there. That was old man ramble there.
Somehow I just picture you at a stove.
Yeah, that's it.
Trying to vote.
Damn, not working.
Tight about trivia time coming up next. We have a special, special prize package for you.
Oh, man.
Here.
This book. Oh.
Yeah, we'll tell you about it when we come back. If you'd like that surprise, though, 416-870-1050, 1-855-591-6876. Those are the numbers to call. Need 2 competitors and 1 spare. Tonight, I think we need the spare. It's The Law, live audio rest and Tedabot Trivia next, right here on TSN 1050 Toronto. You can feel the raw excitement from the look on their faces. The truth is you can find us wherever you are. Just
look up, we're flying high with the stars, cuz... And now, it's time to begin our first bout of the evening.
It is the greatest sports and entertainment spectacular of all time.
This bout is one heck of a ring-ding-dong dandy.
Every time you think you got all the answers, I change the question.
Go one-on-one and get it done.
Nice shot, baby.
This is live audio wrestling's title bout trivia.
Woo, woo, woo. You know it.
All right, let's do this. It's Ted about trivia time. First of all, before we get our contestants on the line, who would like to explain the prize package? Because this is a con, John.
Well, it's going to be a combination of some of the worst prizes we can possibly put together. Some of them are going to be some mystery items because I'm not quite aware of them. But the highlight of this is the 2011 release of Rope Opera, How WCW Killed Vince Russo by the man himself, my worst DVD of the year. Recipient, Vince Russo's second book to his highly touted first book, Forgiven.
Yeah, this one is a real doozy. Some of the stuff that
guess what? It's everyone else's fault. It's
unbelievable.
Spoiler.
Yeah, unbelievable. Some of the stuff he says in this book.
Somebody's going to win some crap here. Wai, who is on the line?
On line two, we got Ray, who's in Alberta.
All right, and?
And he's competing against Alan in Calgary. Mississauga.
Where's Alan?
Line three.
Line three. Okay, Ray, you there?
Hey, I'm here.
And yeah. Alan?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay. You guys sound identical. Okay, here we go, guys. 10 questions. Ray, you're going to go first. We're going to go back and forth. Person who gets the most wins. Ray, here we go. On August 24th, 2012, what WWE performer was arrested for a DUI and offered to bribe the police officer?
It was one of the
Alex Riley?
Hey, guys.
Yeah, one at a time.
Ray, your question.
One at a time.
Alex Riley?
Incorrect.
Can you say the alphabet backwards?
It is a Cameron, a.k.a. Ariane Andrew, one of the Funkadactyls.
Yes.
Alan, this one's for you now. That means, Ray, you don't talk. On November 21st, 2012, what WWE diva was arrested for not paying a speeding ticket?
I'll go with Naomi.
No, you were on the right track. I heard a K out of your mouth. Caitlin would have been the correct answer there. Back over to you now, Ray. Let's play the name game. Who is Andrew Galloway? What's his ring name?
Gallows?
No.
You're wrong!
It is Drew McIntyre. Alan, over to you. Who is Ryan Reeves?
Ryback.
Ryback! Correct.
Winner, chicken dinner!
We're going to reverse the game for you now. I'll give you the gimmick name. You give me the real name. Ray, Julia Riley, who's that?
Claire Lynch.
Correct.
Oh, man. Someone actually
said it on the show earlier.
Yeah, I know, but still.
Yep. Alan, how about Ashley Simmons? Who's that?
No idea.
Cool. Madison Rain.
You absolutely suck.
Madison Rain was the correct answer there. It's 1-1 going into the fourth here. Ray, there were three WWE U.S. champions this year. Name two of them. Ray?
Title's at an all-time high.
Ray, I think your phone's dying. You there?
Uh-oh.
Oh, man.
Wrong.
Yes.
Wrong.
Ray? Well,
yeah.
Are you there?
Yeah. I said Antonio Cesaro and Kofi Kingston.
No, that is incorrect. Kofi Kingston was not.
That's not it.
Antonio Cesaro, Santino Marella, Jack Swagger. Alan, over to you now. There were three TNA X Division champions this year. Name two of them.
Austin Aries and Z-Maya.
Correct. Very good.
Let
you take the lead.
Celebration begin, guys.
Ray, you need this to tie. The Slammy Award this year for trending of the year, trending whatever the year, was given to hashtag Feed Me More. Name one other hashtag up against it.
Hashtag yes.
Nope. That is incorrect.
You absolutely suck.
Correct answer of nominees were People Power, WWWYKA, which is woo, 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 you know it, which Braden uses a ridiculous amount, and hashtag Little Jimmy, which I've never seen anyone say. So with that in mind, Alan, you've already got two. You defeated Ray's one, and Ray almost got defeated by his own phone. Congratulations, Alan. Hold on the line. You win some terrible prizes. Easy as that.
Getting a phone call from Braden.
Yeah, we got 3 minutes left here. Wait, we got some other calls on the line.
Yes, we do. Let's go to Mike from Regina on line one.
Line one. Hi there, Mike. Welcome to the show.
Hey, guys. I was just going to bring up, as far as really dropping the ball this year, how badly they've mishandled Sheamus all year.
Why do you say they've mishandled Sheamus?
He went from having not having a match at all, really, on WrestleMania. All year he was stuck in dead-end feuds. He had that whole lame skit where he stole the car. And just recently, now he's turned into kind of like John Cena Jr. Now, comedy guy.
I find that you're right with the John Cena Jr., but in general, I mean, he's been pretty prominent on, you know, the SmackDown side. I've been featured. He's got a big push behind him because being called John Cena Jr.
is a vote of confidence.
Yeah, the second basically top babyface in the company he's been given. Now, I agree with you. I hate the character. I think he was better off probably a year ago in regards to his character. But as far as his importance in the company, I think it's risen this year, actually.
It just feels feels like they don't have much confidence in the last few months. Since, I mean, he lost clean to Big Show in that last match there. And I don't know if he'll do any better next year. I mean, this was basically as good as they can get him, you know, having titles for most of the year this year, right? But
well, I think that they've just got to get him and Big Show away from each other. Like, how long has this feud been going on?
From what I saw this week, it seems like they want it to still keep going.
Well, that's the problem, is that there isn't that other babyface. Yeah. I mean, Alberto Del Rio looks to be next in line, and what a week he had. I mean, just horrible quality control going from Raw to SmackDown this week. It was two different people, essentially.
It was.
And the other guy that you were pushing as babyface, Orton, he's out again. He's hurt again.
Yeah, I have to say, I put my brain on hold, and I enjoyed Monday Night Raw and the Christmas edition of it, and Santa getting hit by Del Rio. I howled at the beginning of it. I enjoyed it, and I liked Santa coming back with the little with the heartbeat, turning into jingle bells as well. Yeah. I put my brain on hold and actually enjoyed it, which is surprising. Only a minute left. That means we are going to wrap this program for another year. That was the worst of 2012. Thank you all.
Our guest for next week.
Yes. I was going there, John.
Right.
I was going there.
Remind you.
Well, go for it. Mention it.
Well, the Law Roundtable is coming back next week, and we've got the Shockmaster himself, Tom Lawler,
yeah,
will join us live next week on the program to chat with us about not just MMA, but I think we'll spend a lot of it chatting pro wrestling.
Tom Lawler is a huge pro wrestling fan. We've told the we've talked about it on this show before in regards to the fact that he knew Wai and John. He listens to this show every week.
He listens to the podcast. The fact that he knows who the Shockmaster is and would actually put the mask and helmet together to do the gimmick and trip at the weigh-ins, that was amazing.
Wai better than Tensai's version at the Slammy.
Yes, that's right.
Very true. So that's next week. Tom Lawler live here for a half hour on the program, joining our roundtable. So be here for that, or should I say, don't you dare miss it.
Brother!